Amen. I want to thank those brethren who led us so wonderfully in our worship service thus far. And I want to thank you for your wonderful participation in our scripture reading and our singing as well as our prayer. God has just been so good to all of us. We're so thankful and grateful that we are his children and he is indeed our Father. We want our visitors and our guests to know that the doors of the Ferguson Heights Church of Christ swing open on welcome hinges for you and for yours. And we just are so grateful and thankful that you have chosen to grace our audience on this Lord's Day morning. Amen. Turn your Bibles, if you please, to Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14 through 21. And there is a word from the Lord. Ephesians chapter 3, beginning with verse number 14, the Bible reads, "For this season, or for this reason, brother, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen." Church, today we're going to continue our study, part two, on turning on spiritual power. That's what we're talking about. Turning on spiritual power. We talked last week about our inner strength, the indwelling Christ. The next three points that I want to emphasize is from this text is incomprehensible love, infinite fullness, and internal power. Stay with me, I'm on my way somewhere. We began last Sunday looking at Ephesians 3, 14 through 21. And at that time, I told you that Ephesians can be compared to an automobile. Yeah. Chapters 1 through 3 describe for us our power plant. Paul carefully details all of the spiritual resources that are available to us as the mystery body. Chapters 4 through 6 gives us our road map. Paul says, here is the dedication you are to take in your lifestyle. With all of this new power that you have in Jesus Christ. However, as we noted on last week, if you please, you can have the finest automobile, the best map available, a full tank of gas,
But, I say but, if you don't stick in the key and turn on the ignition, you'll never go anywhere. Am I right about it? And so it is with our Christian life. God has given us all the spiritual resources that we need. He has shown us the direction that we are to go. But we will never move if we don't turn on the power. It's movement without might. Now, chapter 3, verse 14 through 21 is our ignition switch, as it were. Here Paul gives the Christian 5 progressive steps that if followed, it will unleash spiritual power within the believer. As we look at this passage, chapter 3, 14 through 21, remember now, last week, we examined the first 2 steps. You remember what they were? Number 1, inner strength. Paul says, if you want to know spiritual power in your life, you need to begin by being strengthened with might through God's Spirit in your inner being. Paul is talking about the kind of stability, the kind of character that stands rooted and grounded and firm on the principles of God's Word. That is, you are not blown around by every wind of doctrine. You're grounded and rooted. You're not bamboozled by every new show that comes in town. You want to stick and stay with the word, the will, and the way of God. And there is only one way you will ever have this strong inner man, and that is by God's Spirit. Every time we have a decision to make, when we yield to the Spirit, listen now, whenever you get ready to make a decision, when you yield to the Spirit as He instructs us out of His Word, we strengthen our inner man. Yes, we can stand strong and confident about what we're doing and where we're going. And as we continue to yield, our inner man gets stronger and stronger, and it becomes easier to say yes to the Spirit and no to sin. You know, it's hard to say no sometimes. But as you start exercising and building up and strengthening your spiritual man, it gets easy. No, you ain't coming here tonight. Well, y'all know what I mean. Just make the right decision and do the right thing. Hold me up, Holy Ghost. That leads to the second step, the indwelling Christ. Once you yield to the Holy Spirit and He is controlling your life, decision by decision, then Christ is able to settle down in you and be at home. Y'all remember that? You remember the little book I mentioned last week that pictures the Christian's heart as a home? As a house, if Christ is constantly having to run around, cleaning, sweeping, chastising, chastening, exhorting, and so forth and so on, He'll never feel at home in your life. For you to turn on spiritual power in your life, Christ must not only come into your heart, but He must be able to settle down and feel comfortable in your heart. And even, you know, sometimes you go to a folk house and they say, make yourself at home. But then they say, take off your shoe. Don't sit over there, sit over here. Don't do this, do that. What you want to eat? Well, this is all I got. Well, you want to be comfortable. You see what I'm saying? And Christ want to be comfortable in your heart. He want to be settled down. He don't mind fixing things that are broke, but he wants you to take care of you and be the best you that you can be. Think about it. For you to turn on spiritual power in your life, Christ must not only come into your heart, but he got to be able to settle down and feel comfortable there. And he can only do that as you surrender him every room, every closet, every dimension of your life must be turned over to Christ, and Jesus will do you no harm. If he can't help you, he won't hurt you, and he's always able to help you. Above and beyond what you're able to imagine and even think. Think about it. So as you yield to the Spirit of God, he controls you. And as your life is brought under his control, it is being directed and guided and cleansed by the Word of God so that Christ can settle down and be at home. And once Christ has that kind of dominion in your life, then you're ready for the next step. And that's incomprehensible love. Look at Ephesians chapter 3, verse 17 and 19. The Bible says that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. There's a lot of good preaching right there, church. When Christ dwells, I'm talking about incomprehensible love now. When Christ dwells in our hearts, I mean, when he settles down and is really at home in our hearts, then we will be rooted and established in love. And why is this true, brother preacher? Because the essence of God is love. Paul put it pretty clearly in Romans chapter 5 and verse number 5, when he wrote, God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us. The moment we are saved, God begins to pour his love into our hearts. It is expected then that we, in turn, will show that love to other folk. You see, if you are not rooted and grounded in love, you will not keep the practical commands of Ephesians chapter 4 through 6. It is love, church, that prompts us to want to speak the truth to our neighbor. If you're lying to your neighbor, you don't love him. Speak the truth. God has poured his love out into our hearts so that we can be like him. And God don't lie. It is love that will move the thief to no longer want to steal. Am I right about it? It is love that will cause the Christian to cease his sexual immorality. It is love that prompts a wife to submit to her husband. It got to be love that makes a woman say to do the things the way she do. I mean, not always about pleasing herself, but because it ain't natural just to run home and start cooking, run home and start cleaning, run home and run somebody some bath water. Yeah, y'all. Y'all do what y'all do. You got to love a person the way they need to be loved. Everybody don't need that. But if you get with somebody, remember, you got to love them the way they need to be loved. Am I right about it? And
it is love that prompts a husband to care for his wife as he will for his own body. That is why it's so important for the Christian to be rooted and grounded in love. If you claim to be a Christian, but love is not the foundation of your lifestyle, and you don't seize love as the expression for dealing with every situation, and you don't understand and know love experientially, then the problem is not that the people around you are giving you trouble. The problem is that Christ is not comfortable in your heart because you are not yielding to the control of the Spirit in your life. Christ, God, the Holy Spirit is about love. And if I don't have to love you, but if you love God, you ain't going to curse me out. That's so true. You see, because you're going to let your light shine to bring God glory. You see, you're going to love your enemies. You're going to pray for those that despitefully use you and curse you out. You know, because that's what God would have us to do. And you got to understand that. Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22. In Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22, the Bible tells me that when I start walking in the Spirit, that the Spirit of God will produce certain fruit in my life. And the very first one mentioned is love. Yes, it is, too. And as Christ settled down and is at home in my heart, his love will begin to permeate my thoughts, permeate my actions, and permeate my words. And what I do and the reason I do it, it will all be because of love. And I learned to love folk I don't even like. Look at Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 2. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 2 says, and walk in love, as Christ also has loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. Walk in love. Do you know anybody worth suffering for? I mean, you go through some stuff you wouldn't have to go through. I don't have to deal with that. You know. But I'm putting up with that. I'm not just putting up with it. I'm embracing it. Because I love you. God loves you. And you're worth suffering for. We were worth suffering for. The Bible says, yet while we were sinners, God sent his son. It's not like we said we're sorry. He died for us while we were actively sinning and crucifying him afresh. While he was on the cross, he did his best work. He did his best work on this time side of eternity when they hung him high and stretched him wide and dropped him low, and he was suffering the most. Yes. Because he was suffering for folk that he loved. Yes. What kind of love should we have? Sacrificial love. A love that puts the best interest of others first. If you're having a tough time loving others like this, then you need to get back
into the Word of God. Yield to the Spirit of God. Let God, the Holy Spirit, have control over your life so that Christ can settle down and fill your life with His love. God is love. And we love Him because He first loved us. And love is powerful. Love can conquer hate. Now, notice that Paul says only as we are grounded in love will we begin to be able to grasp the greatness of Christ's love for us. You got to be grounded in love if you want to understand this love that Jesus, this redemptive love, this unconditional love. There is only one thing that understands love. Do you know what that is? It's love. A reporter was interviewing Louis Armstrong once, and he asked Louis about jazz. And Louis Armstrong said, "Man, if I got to explain it, you ain't got it. You ain't got it." And that's how it is with love. Love is a commodity only understood by love. Y'all don't hear me. You see, for example, only a parent can comprehend the love that a new parent feels for his or her child. And it's only as you are rooted and grounded in love that you can begin to understand, embrace, and grasp the love of Jesus. And notice the way Paul put it in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 18. He says that you may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width, length, depth, and height. He's talking about God's love. How wide is Christ's love? It's wide enough to embrace all men, Jew and Gentile, and make of them one body. How long? How long is Christ's love? It's the love of Christ. It began in eternity past, and it goes on to eternity future. It never quits, church. How deep is the love of Christ? It's deep enough to reach into the deepest pit of sin and lift up the rankest sinner and embrace him. Ain't nobody too bad that the love of Jesus won't reach him. You haven't done enough wrong to be denied the love of Jesus. You haven't messed up that much because He already died and laid down His life for you, and He won't let you go. God pursues us with an everlasting love. Think about it. There is not one thing in the universe that can get outside of the love of Christ. There is no person outside the reach of the love of Jesus. And when you begin to experience that kind of love in your daily and everyday life, then you're well on your way to living life at full throttle. If you want to turn on the spiritual power, I said if you want to turn on some spiritual power, if you want to live up to your full potential according to the riches you have in Christ Jesus, first, You must be strong in your inner man. Second, Christ must be comfortably settled down in your heart. Don't grieve the Spirit. And third, the love of Christ. Church, I said the love of Christ must be oozing from every fiber of your life. God will not release his power in an unloving heart. He just won't do it. Now here's the climax of point number four or point number two, depending on whether you're looking at it from last week or this week. Here's the climax. Infinite fullness, inner strength, indwelling Christ, incomprehensible love. Now, infinite fullness. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 19 says, to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge. You know, sometimes folk be like, I don't know why he loved her, or why she loved him, or why that tall woman won with that short man. You know, but love can do some things to you. You know, if that was my child, I'd put in my, no, it ain't your child. You see, and when somebody loves somebody, my Lord, if you love me like I love you, won't nothing break that love in two. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 19, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. This is some good stuff right here. What Paul is saying here just totally blows my mind. To think that somehow and some way the God who feels all in all could feel me and come and live in me. Church, that's incredible. That is incredible. He, God, in his totality, lives in us. He lives in me. And he wants to fill me with all of his person, his characteristics, his attributes. That's incredible to me. How can we understand this? Well, before we try to get a handle on it, I want you to see that God never intended for Christians to function on a half a tank. Y'all hear what I'm saying? He wants us full. Look at, let me get you. Y'all want a little lip. You want some script. Yeah, let me give you some script. Turn to Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 23. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 23. The Bible says, which in his body, we are the body, the fullness of him who what? Fills all in all. Isn't that all right? Turn to Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 13. The Bible says, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the what? The fullness of Christ. Look at Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 18. He says, and do not be drunk with what? With wine, in which is dissipation. But be what? Filled with the Spirit. may not know much about a thimble. Grandmamas used to have it. It was a thimble. And I have a thimble. And I go down to the Mississippi, the muddy Missouri, or just say I go to the Lake of the Ozarks. And I scoop out a thimble full. Okay? I don't have the lake in the thimble. The lake is still there. And the lake won't even miss that thimble full. But you know what? I have the fullness of that lake in my thimble. In the sense that every ingredient that makes up the water in that lake is also in my thimble. If there is pollution in the lake, there's pollution in my thimble. All the essential character of that lake is in that thimble. You want to know something? All of the essential attributes of God, when you are filled with the fullness of God, are in you. If God is love, then a believer filled with the fullness of God is going to express love. If God is wise, the believer filled with the fullness of God is going to express godly wisdom. If God is holy, the believer who is filled with the fullness of God is going to express godly holiness. Do y'all see this? To be filled with the fullness of God means that you have the qualities of God within you to a smaller measure, so that you can reflect to the world what God is like. It is to be God-like before an ungodly world. Holy, pure, loving, gracious, merciful. Can't you see how God could release spiritual power through you when your life radiates his qualities? The process begins when we say yes to the Spirit and no to sin. Oh, y'all want one of them hallelujah sermons, don't you? Hey, this is good stuff, though. This will teach you how to live and help you to die. You see, the process begins when you say yes to the Spirit and no to sin. Our inner man being grows in strength. Then Christ can settle down in our hearts, so his love can be channeled through us. He sends blessings to us that he can send through us. As that happens, God begins to fill us with his fullness, inner strength, indwelling Christ, incomprehensible love, inner or infinite fullness. Finally, let me say a word about this internal power. In Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20, the Bible says, "Now to him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us." When you are filled with all the fullness of God, when his attributes become a part of your life, then God can unleash his power in your life. You will have all the spiritual energy that you need to walk and to walk in victory. Y'all hear what I'm saying? You'll be able to live life to its fullness, and you'll be able to deal with the challenges of life that come your way. Now, have you caught on that as powerful as God is, you or the trigger that determines whether he's able or not in your life to accomplish all that he would through you. You see, verses 20 through 21 are not true in the life of every believer. It's not true. Not every Christian enjoys the tremendous spiritual power that God has available to him or her. Only the person who knows inner strength, only the person who knows the indwelling Christ, incomprehensible love, and who is filled with infinite fullness can know the unlimited power of God in his Christian walk. I want you to see the pyramid of power that Paul says is ours. Now, God is powerful. Am I right about it? And if you are filled with all the fullness of God, then you're filled with his power. Look at how Paul describes it in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20. Emphasis minds. Now to him who is what?
Able.
Now to him who is able to do. Now to him who is able to do what? To him who is able to do what we ask, now to him who is able to do what we ask or imagine, now to him who is able to do all we ask or imagine, I mean all that we can even ask or just imagine, now to him who is able to do more than all we ask or imagine. Your mind can't even fathom what God can do. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. How? According to his power that is at work within us. The power is in us. Listen, church. God does not ask you to walk the Christian life in your own strength. Because I know I was messed up. And I often wonder, well, why I keep doing the same thing over and over again? I mean, I wasn't even committing new sin. It was like the same. You just stuck on stupid. You know, folks say, yeah, okay, when you get tired, when it hurts, it ain't never, you keep on, then you come home crying. Why let him do that to me? What done happened? How did it happen? You know, I just, and then you got to have a little talk with Jesus. And when you have that little talk with Jesus, that can make everything all right if you listen to him. You got the power. You just won't put the key in and turn it on. You keep trying to walk in your own strength when you got to yield. You got to give up. You got to turn loose. And you got to let God. And if it's not happening, don't quit asking. Don't quit begging. In the fullness of time, God is the old time and the end time God. He may not be there when you want it, but he's always on time because he hears you is crying because you hurt and you broke and you busted and you disgusted and you got hurts and happiness and hang-ups. And you crying, Lord Jesus, help me. And God saying, no, you ain't ready. But instead of saying, I got one more run in me. Well, I can go out there one more time. And God knows. But he can fix you. And he knows when you're ready. I was telling them in Bible class about the parent whooping the child, and as soon as you raise the bell, he screamed, "Ah, you're killing me! Ah, it hurt!" Ain't nothing wrong. And then if you saw, if you gonna stop, okay, now don't do it no more. And he gone right back, just waiting to do it the next time. But when God whoop you, you can scream all you want to. God knows when you're ready. He knows when you're ready. And when God put it on you, hold me up, Holy Ghost. That doesn't fool do me wrong. I just keep on loving. Because like y'all always hear me say, just tell God on folk. Because God can do things to them that's illegal for me to do. And boy, you want a whooping, God will get you. So according to God, does not ask you to walk the Christian life in your own strength. He elected you. He redeemed you. He sealed you. He raised you up. He seated you at his right hand. He gave you spiritual life when you were spiritually dead. He put you in the mystery body. God has done it all. And he completes. You hear what I'm saying? He ain't through with you yet. Because he completes what he has started by supplying you with the power you need to walk in victory. Y'all hear what I'm saying? There is no limit to what God can do through my life or yours when we follow his path. We have to yield to the Spirit. We have to be strengthened. We have to be strengthened in the inner man. We have to be filled with Christ. We have to be filled with his love. We have to be filled with the fullness of God. Then the power will flow through us. Now, why does God do all of this? Why? Because, you know, when some folk keep acting up, we just say, "I'm done. I ain't don't even come." That's a deal breaker. You know, folk have deal breakers. You done what? You stayed out all night? Don't you come here no more. You came home without your check? I'm done. You know, that folk only go so far with folk. Am I right about it? It ain't nothing but the love of God that keep us keeping on. And God do all of this because the Bible says in Ephesians 3:21, and I'm done. To him be glory. In the church, by Christ Jesus, to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. God wants to be glorified. God wants men to see how good and great he really is. And he can see that through you. God good to you. God is great in your life. If you got a God that ain't making you look good, if you got a God that you can't brag on, and then you need to try my God. You see, and it's only one, you just got to turn on the power. You see, and the glory, God's glory is supposed to come through us, the church. But it will not happen until the church really uses her resources. Mark this down. If the church isn't what it ought to be, God is not glorified as he ought to be glorified. If the church is dead, God is dead. From the world's perspective. You see, but when the world sees us walking in spiritual power, and then God is magnified. So we are living at the task for our God. And if God is to be glorified in the church, it is to be because the church is moving in an expression of the mighty power that he has. Ephesians 3:20 and 21, we got to read it. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask of thee, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. Y'all hear what I said?
Amen.
I said amen, church.
Amen.
And amen means so let it be. Can y'all say that?
So
let it be. Can you look at your own life and say, God, if that is what you want, so let it be. Let my life glorify your name among me. Do you really want to give God glory? Start at the beginning, one step at a time. And when the spiritual power is turned on in your life, then God will get the glory that he's worthy of. So let it be. Let's make that our prayer this day and this week, that God will be glorified through us, the body of Christ. And I tell you, as I always tell you, because this is what's most important. The gospel consists of facts, commands, and promises. We must believe the facts, obey the commands, and then we can enjoy the promises. If you would have faith in Jesus, that faith will change your heart. If you repent of your sins, that'll change your life. If you will be buried in the watery grave of baptism, that'll change your state. Forgiveness of sin will remove your guilt, and the gift of the Holy Spirit will make you a partaker of the divine nature of God. You can say no to the world and yes to Jesus and be born again right now of the Spirit and the water. Don't make me beg you to do what you know you ought to do. As together we stand and give glory, give God glory and praise.
198, power in the blood.
Power in the blood, 198. You.